back to the nearest in the hopes that you remember the last one I see. We are preparing to do our hanging baskets for the outside of the church again this year. We've decided to have a go ourselves. So anybody who would like to come and join us, as yet haven't got a date, but if you're interested in coming and having a natter, a brew, and do some planting, would you let me know, please, and then I can include those people when I do know the date but want to do it. A week on Monday, we've got a police surgery here between 7 and 8. Anything you want to come and chat to the local police, or if you just want to welcome the new sergeant for the area, who is a local lad. Next Saturday, we've got a concert here, Worsley Concert Band. It's £3 for the tickets, and it's for Ukraine. So if anybody's interested, there is a notice on the notice board. It's still under the new this week bit. I've not moved it yet. And last of all, but definitely not least, a number of you will know that Deacon Debbie has got COVID, sadly. But Worsley Road North prayers will still go ahead this evening between 7 and 7.30. Again, you can just pop in for a couple of minutes, pop in, light a candle, or you can stay for the whole time if you choose to. That's the end of the notices, and just say a warm welcome to Trevor.
Call to worship. We've come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Amen. Now all my hymns today are from hymns and psalms, because I still like hymns and psalms. And I hope I'll pick some good ones for you. But, and I do like the first one. It's an Isaac Watts hymn. You know what? Isaac Watts wrote hymns because he said to his father as a young man, a young boy really, your hymns are boring, Dad, because he was a pastor. He was imprisoned, actually. He was a nonconformist. Isaac Watts, his father. I'm rambling a bit, aren't I? But anyway, he said to Isaac Watts, if you're bored and you don't like the hymns, write your own. And Isaac Watts has written some wonderful hymns. This is not his best, but it's one I like. And it's 810 in hymns and psalms. Come, let us join our cheerful song with angels round. Lord, you are far, far more. praise you because you are the source of all that is good and true and free. It is your desire to fill our lives, our thoughts and our hearts with all your goodness, truth and love. We praise you that you are a God who longs to set all creation free. Free not to please ourselves or make our own selfish plans or seek our individual personal satisfaction, but free to be the people you always meant us to be from the very beginning. Lord, you offer your offer of freedom begins with an empty cross, an empty tomb, and the emptying out of the Holy Spirit. In the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, you have demonstrated your power to set all things free. And so we praise you for the promise that we shall be with him, that in him we shall have all the resources of heaven and earth to enable us to praise you as you truly deserve. And Lord, may the freedom you give us in Christ bring you endless glory. We ask these prayers in the name of Christ, the one who sets us free. Amen. And a prayer of confession. Father, we are only too well aware that we are not the people you meant us to be. We're not living the kind of lives that you created us to live. And our words and thoughts and deeds are not bringing you the glory that they were designed to do. Forgive us, Father, for the way that through our plans and dreams and choices we damage your world. We hurt each other and we create barriers between ourselves and you. So we ask that you will not only forgive us, but that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you will cleanse and renew us. For Christ's sake we pray. Amen. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Question, do you want the talk or not? Right, okay.
Yes.
I see I've got two people from Trinity here, and she's lovely to see, but I was going to do this sermon next week in Trinity. I'm going to have to do another one now. Right, today's theme, really, the gospel reading today is about shepherd, Jesus the Good Shepherd. So I thought, can you hear me or should I go back to the mic?
Just carry the mic.
So I thought I'd do something about shepherds and test your knowledge of the Bible. Right? So next slide, please, Stephen. Okay. You're going to tell me who they are and what's the story. The key is the right hand picture.
Yes.
Brothers. The children of Adam and Eve, say it again, Graham.
Cain and Abel,
right? Cain was the firstborn, he was the farmer, Abel was the shepherd, that's him holding the lamb, because they made a sacrifice to God, and God seemed to favour Abel's sacrifice more than Cain, and Cain, in a fit of jealousy, did what?
Murdered him,
and then was condemned to a life of wandering. Where he wandered, I'm not quite sure, but he wandered. So that's Cain and Abel. Abel, a shepherd. Next one.
Can you just bring the microphone so up near you? Sorry.
Sure.
You don't have to stand like I'm carrying across if you want.
All right.
That's it. Just so people at home can hear that.
Right, okay. So next on the next slide. With whom did Abraham fall out before the land, because the land could not feed two flocks of sheep at the same time? Clue, his wife turned into a pillar of salt.
Lot.
Abraham and Lot, I think Lot was Abraham's nephew. They argued about grazing rights because the land was fairly inhospitable. Abraham, rather magnanimously, gave Lot the choice of where to go, and foolishly he chose where? Sodom and Gomorrah. Abraham went to Hebron, or Hebron. And of course, Sodom and Gomorrah was a terrible place. Lot was told to leave, his wife was told not to look back. And of course, she couldn't resist it, and she turned around, and the story is she was turned into a pillar of salt. Which reminds me of the story of this being told to a Sunday school class, and the teacher said that Lot's wife turned back and she turned into a pillar of salt. And this little lad at the back said, "That's nothing. My mother was learning to drive and she turned into a telegraph pole." Next one. This is... Yeah? Anybody get that one? Not the joke, the picture. Had to. Somebody was going to sacrifice his son, Isaac and Jacob. It was a test of faith, wasn't it? And he got him on the, he built an altar, and he was just about to actually kill him, and he heard a ram bleating in a bush. And God told Isaac to take the ram and sacrifice him in the place of his son, and renewed his covenant. Again, another shepherd. Next one. The story started in Egypt and ended in Midian. The key is the left hand. The key is the left hand one because it's Egypt. The Israelites were in Egypt. I knew I shouldn't have done this. You're looking at me completely blank. It's Moses. Moses saw the Egyptians maltreating the Hebrews, who were, I think, making bricks from these straw bricks. And in a flash of temper, Moses, who was a shepherd, or he became a shepherd, killed one of the overseers, one of the Egyptians, and then fled to Midian, where he became a shepherd. Next one. Why were lambs important to the story of the Passover? Again, shepherds. What did they have to do? Slaughter a lamb, we're told to slaughter a lamb, dip a bunch of this hyssop into the blood, put the blood on the lintels, and the angel of death passed over the house of the Israelites and killed the firstborn of the Egyptians. This was after the Egyptians had suffered, if you remember, 10 plagues. And after this, Pharaoh said to the Israelites, "You can go." And of course, the key was that's the parting of the Red Sea. Whether that actually happened is debatable. Next one. you'll get that one.
Goliath.
David and Goliath. David was a shepherd boy. Goliath was supposedly a 9-foot giant. He was a Philistine. He challenged the Israelites to contest of the champions, and then the war would be settled. Whichever champion won, his side would win the war. Saul wasn't very keen on taking on a 9-foot giant full of armour and a long spear, but David, the shepherd boy, he said he'd take him on. And he went to the river, he got 5 smooth pebbles. When Goliath saw David, he was enraged. David called on his God, which really upset the Goliath. Goliath charged at David. David used his sling, his shepherd's sling, and killed him. We with a stone to the middle of his head. And then, of course, the Old Testament isn't particularly gruesome, is it really? He then went and cut off his head. Next one. What are the qualities of a good shepherd? Just the pictures, really. You'll get this again in the sermon, but I mean, he had to be strong. That's the left-hand picture. He had to look after his lambs, care for his lambs. Next slide. He had to lead his flock. He didn't follow them, he led the flock. And of course, the right-hand one is he acted as a guard. Because in the Middle East, at night, they put their sheep either in a cave or in a stone sheepfold. But they had no door and no roof. And so the shepherd would sleep in the opening to protect his flock from wild animals and bandits. And the last one, I think. No, we've got two. Why are shepherds important in the New Testament? The key is the left hand one is the key, and the right hand one should be. Who did God announce the birth of Jesus to first of all?
Shepherds.
Who visited Jesus first of all?
Shepherds.
The shepherds in the Bible. And then the last one is
verse 5.
Of course, the answer is who is known as the good shepherd. Which is what the sermon's about, and you won't hear it next week. I've already decided I'll change it.
We promise we won't get the answers.
No, I won't do this either. So Christians are compared to sheep all the time because we are to follow our master, follow our leader. Just as the sheep follow the shepherd, so Christians are supposed to follow, try to follow Jesus. Okay. Right. My wife said, who reads all my stuff, she said, do you think they'll get this?
We're testing your knowledge.
Right, where are we up to? A hymn. How sweet the name of Jesus sounds. 257. Following that, we'll have the offertory after this hymn. Okay, 257. How sweet the name of Jesus sounds.
Yeah.
gifts of money as a token, an expression of our longing to serve you and to be known as one of your followers. We would ask you to take these gifts of money, use them and our lives in the work of your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now pray with you.
Thank you. Guides me in the right path, as he has promised. Even if I go through the deepest, darkest darkness, I will not be afraid. For you are with me. Your shepherd's rod and staff protect me. You prepare a path. Kind of put me off reading that psalm because I was so used to reading it as a Sunday school poem. I had to learn it on my heart. And the words are slightly different. Thank you anyway, Trevor.
Thank you. And of course, our next hymn is based on that psalm, 69. The King of Love, my Shepherd, is whose goodness faileth never. Can I switch this mic off, Steve?
I've left it off, so it's on now.
I'm
John chapter 10, verses 11 to 13. Then Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." Simon Peter went aboard and dragged the net ashore full of big fish, 153 in all. Even though there were so many, still the net did not tear. Jesus said to them, "Come and eat." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. So Jesus went over, took the bread and gave it to them. He did the same with the fish. This then was the third time Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from death. After they had eaten, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these others do?" "Yes, Lord," he answered, "you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Take care of my lambs." A second time, Jesus said to him, "Simon, son of God, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," he answered, "you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Take care of my sheep." A third time, Jesus said, "Simon, son of God, do you love me?" Peter was sad because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" So he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Take care of my sheep. I am telling you the truth. When you were young, you used to get ready and go anywhere you wanted to. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will bind you." And in saying this, Jesus was indicating the way in which Peter would die and bring glory to God. Then Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned round and saw behind him that other disciple whom Jesus loved, the one who had leaned close to Jesus at the meal and had asked, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked Jesus, "Lord, what about this man?" Jesus answered him, "If I want him to live until I come, what is that to you? Follow me." So a report spread among the followers of Jesus that this disciple would not die, but Jesus did not say that he would not die. He said, "If I want him to live until I come, what is that to you?" He is the disciple who spoke of those things, the one who also wrote them down, and we know that what he said is true. Now there are many other things that Jesus did. If they were all written down one by one, I suppose that the whole world would not hold the books that would be written. That's not the right one, because it's not what I read in my Bible. No, it's all right. It's all right. I didn't think it sounded right.
I think what just
it's read, that. It's that one.
Just read from.
I'll read if I it's all right. If I'm not taking the time. The parable of the shepherd. Jesus said, "I am telling you the truth. The man who goes does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in some other way as a thief and a robber. The man who goes in through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him. The sheep hear his voice, as he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he has brought them out, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him, because they know his voice. They will not follow someone else. Instead, they will run away from such a person because they do not know his voice." Jesus told them this parable, but they did not understand what he meant. So Jesus said again, "I am telling you the truth. I am the gate for the sheep. All others who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever comes in by me, who will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only in order to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come in order that you might have life, life in all its fullness. I am the good shepherd who is willing to die for the sheep. sheep, sees a wolf coming, he leaves the sheep and runs away. So the wolf snatches the sheep and scatters them. The hired man runs away because he is only a hired man and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, as the Father knows me, and I know the Father in the same way I know my sheep, and they know me, and I am willing to die for them. There are other sheep which belong to me that are not in this sheepfold. I must bring them too. They will listen to my voice, and they will become one flock with one shepherd. The Father loves me because I am willing to give up my life in order that I may receive it back again. No one takes my life away from me. I give it up my own free will. I have the right to give it up, and I have the right to take it back. This is what my Father has commanded me to do. Again, there was a division among the people because of these words, many of them were saying, "He has a demon. He is mad. Why do you listen to him?" But others were saying, "A man with a demon could not talk like this. How could a demon recite to blind people?" It was winter, and the festival of the dedication of the temple was being celebrated in Jerusalem. Jesus was walking in Solomon's porch in the temple when the people gathered round him and asked, "How long are you going to keep us in suspense? Tell us the plain truth. Are you the Messiah?" Jesus answered, "I have already told you, but you would not believe me. The things I do by my Father's authority speak on my behalf, but you will not believe, for you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never die. No one can snatch them away from me. What my Father has given me is greater than everything, and no one can catch them away from me. The Father's care. The Father and I are one. Thanks be to God."
You've got the full picture there, haven't you? Last week we talked about Peter, Jesus denying. The idea was that Jesus asked Peter three times, did he love him, because he denied him three times. There's some suggestion, in actual fact, if you think about that passage, that Jesus said, "Do you love me more than his fishing job?" And Peter said, "Yes, I do." And then he turned and said, "Do you love me more than these?" That's the disciples. And Peter said, "Yes, I do." And then the suggestion is he sort of said, "Do you love me more than the world?" And Peter said, "Yes, I do." And of course, then he told him to feed his sheep, his followers. And today's reading follows on from that, with Jesus describing himself as the good shepherd. So you've got a complete picture now. So I'll not bother preaching the sermon, I'll go on. Hymn 47, "What shall I do, my God, to love?"
My God, to love.
started this sermon and said, I am the good shepherd, and I will lay down my life for the sheep, you'd probably think I was as mad as a hatter. Or if you went to a funeral and somebody stood up and said, I am the resurrection and the life, if you believe in me, you will never die, you'd hope that somebody would push them gently out of the crematorium to wait for an ambulance to take them away. But, you know, Jesus says seven I ams in John's Gospel, which at the time caused a bit of a stir, but which today Christians take very seriously because we think there's a grain of truth in each one of them. Just to remind you, Jesus said, I am the bread of life, I am the light of the world, I am the door for the sheep, I am the good shepherd, I am the resurrection and the life, I am the way, the truth and the life, and I am the true vine. Now the people who first heard those I am statements by Jesus would have been astonished, because they would have understood that he was claiming to be God. They would have remembered that when God spoke to Moses out of the burning bush and told him to go back to Egypt and lead the people to freedom, Moses was worried that people wouldn't believe it. And they would ask him who had told him and given him these instructions. And so Moses asked God, what's his name? And God says, I am who I am. Now, hundreds of years later, Jesus' use of these same words would have created the impression that he was claiming to be God, who was speaking to his people again. No wonder opinion was divided. Some people thought he was bonkers. Other people were prepared to give him the benefit of the doubt. But the image of God as a shepherd who continually directs and guides and cares for his flock is not just a theme that's in the Old Testament, it runs through the New Testament as well. I mean, the best example, of course, is Psalm 23, which portrays God as a shepherd. And it may well have inspired John and Jesus, I suppose, to create this image of Jesus as the Good Shepherd. But even though the image of God and Jesus as a Good Shepherd runs through the, well, it's a constant Bible theme, really, and even though men like Abraham, Jacob, Moses, David, Amos, they were all shepherds, it may surprise you to learn that the shepherds were shunned by polite society because they did a low-grade job which involved days of danger and loneliness. I mean, a shepherd's dress was, he wore a tunic, and over the tunic he wore a sheepskin, and the fleece was turned inwards because it's cold at night in the desert. He wore a piece of woven woolen material around his head to protect him against the sun. On his feet were leather sandals. His equipment consisted of a leather bag in which he carried his food. He had a knife. He also had a water container, a collapsible leather bucket which he used for drawing water from deep wells. He then also used, of course, a sling, and the sling was used to lob stones at sheep which had strayed to drive them back into the flock, or of course to scare off wild animals. He had this long crooked staff which he used as a walking stick and to hook back sheep that had gone astray. And he carried a rod, which was a piece of wood about 3 feet long. The end was about as big as an orange. Into that piece of wood, they put a piece of slate, so it was used as a club to kill wild animals and to defend themselves against robbers who were intent on stealing the sheep. But the nature of his job meant that the shepherd couldn't obey the rules about hand washing and ceremonial cleansing, nor could they obey the stated hours for prayers. So they were despised by the Orthodox Jew. How surprising then, as I said in the children's address, that the birth of Jesus was announced first to shepherds. That the first people to go to the manger were shepherds. That today a bishop uses a shepherd's crook. And that the word pastor comes from the Latin word which means shepherd, whose job it is to care for his flock of Christians. But to really appreciate the meaning, the real meaning of this image of Jesus as a good shepherd, we perhaps need to think about what the shepherd's job actually involved. So a job description of a shepherd might read something like this. He has to know his sheep by name, and he has to train them to respond to his voice only. He must lead them and make sure that it's safe for them to follow. He must take total responsibility so that if a sheep dies or is killed, he can produce the evidence to prove he couldn't stop the death. He must be prepared to lay down his life for his sheep, especially when they're attacked by wild animals and by robber bands. He must use his skill to provide pasture and water in what was an inhospitable landscape. He must be strong to carry an injured or sick lamb around his shoulders. He must inspect the sheep every night by making them pass under his crook as they entered the sheepfold. He must use his skills as a tracker to find sheep that had gone astray. He must be extremely watchful at night and act as a door to the cave or the sheepfold to stop the sheep from wandering and to keep out wild animals and thieves. He must love his job. He must care for his sheep, and he must serve his master. Now that job description of a shepherd in first century Palestine, I suppose, achieves its divine, these great qualities of the shepherd were summed up in the life of Jesus. He had to be strong and courageous to protect his followers. He had to be eternally vigilant to take care of his flock. He had to have infinite patience with his followers who were slow to understand and often were wayward in their discipline. He had to make the ultimate sacrifice, or be prepared to make the ultimate sacrifice, and lay down his own life to save the sheep that had gone astray. And of course, Jesus' image of himself as a good shepherd is worthy of mention. In the Bible, the word good can just mean somebody who is decent and honest and principled. But it can also mean a person who combines those qualities with love and compassion and kindness and understanding. I mean, years ago, people in villages and towns would say, "Oh, I'm going to see the good doctor." They were not only talking about his skill as a physician, but they were saying that the doctor was kind and understanding and compassionate and considerate. And so this image of Jesus as a good shepherd is about more than strength and courage. It's about his love and compassion and understanding for those who follow him. I said earlier that this biblical theme of Jesus as a good shepherd who directs and guides and cares. cares for his flock. Not only is a theme throughout the Bible, but it's been adopted by Christians of every generation. But, you know, what does it mean? Well, in first century Palestine, a shepherd led his flock, and the sheep followed him. The implication is that if you say you are a Christian, then you follow your master. When Billy Graham was asked what it meant to follow Jesus, he made just three simple points. He said, first of all, to follow Jesus means to accept him as your Lord and Saviour. Second, it means that you want him to be the master of your life rather than run things on your own. And third, to follow Jesus means to see other people through the eyes of Jesus. I can't do better than that, can I? And how does he guide us? Well, through the Bible, which is called, of course, the Book of Faith and Practice. Second, by increasing our knowledge of God and Jesus. And third, he guides us if we trust him and believe that through the work of the Holy Spirit, he only ever works for good in our lives. And how does he care for us? Well, John is quite clear. He voluntarily laid down his life so that all men and women may know the grace and love of God and through Jesus Christ find salvation. Now there are lots of other themes in that passage which I can't cover in one sermon. So let me finish by using an example which illustrates the difference following Jesus can make to us if we let him direct and guide. A group of friends were going to have a party, and somebody suggested they should turn it into a sort of a concert, and everybody should do their party piece. And they agreed. So some sang, some recited poetry, some told funny stories, some read favourite passages from a favourite book. One of the guests was a well-known Shakespearean actor. And to everybody's surprise and delight, he repeated the 23rd Psalm. Sitting in a dark corner was an old vicar, desperately hoping nobody would spot him, because he didn't want to do anything. But eventually, he was spotted and asked to do his party piece. And he said, well, I'm too old. My memory's not as good as it used to be. And anyway, the Shakespearean actor, he's already done my party piece. But they rejected all these excuses, and so eventually he got to his feet, cleared his throat, and he began to repeat the 23rd Psalm. And this hushed silence fell over the room. And when he finished and sat down, there was sort of a spontaneous round of applause, and then generous remarks were passed, like, I've never heard anything. I've never been so moved. I now know for the first time what the writer of Psalm 23 was actually trying to tell me. While all this was going on, the Shakespearean actor called for silence and he said, I may know the 23rd Psalm, but our friend here has an advantage over me. He knows the shepherd. The moral of the story is, if we want to lead other people to the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ, the best place to begin is by getting to know the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. And now our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. First of all, our prayers of thanksgiving. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life of forgiveness for the beauty and wonder of all your creation, and that we have a chance to discover and enjoy it. And Father, we thank you for all that you have done for us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, for his life and his ministry on earth, for his teaching about your kingdom, and for his stories that made your love real. We praise you for his death for us in our place as our Saviour, and then his rising again as our Lord. We thank you that we can come on the first day of the week and celebrate again his mighty resurrection. Father, it's because of Christ that we come. It's because of what he has done that we can come into your presence. He opened the way into life that is real and into knowing you as our Father. Enable us not only to thank you, but by your grace, to live thankful lives through Christ our living Lord. Our prayers of intercession. We're asked today to pray for people known to us and those maybe not known to us as well. We're asked to pray for Debbie, Deacon Debbie, for Mavis, Christina and Ray, Edna and everybody at Abbey Vale Nursing Home, the Reverend Joe Wilson who is in hospital, Dorothy and Graham, David, Jackie, Claire, the family of Terry Pickup, Tracy, Doris Lindley, baby Teddy, and Jeff. And in a moment's silence, we add the names of those perhaps known only to us. Pray that all the people we prayed for and all people who are sick and suffering will be treated with love and tenderness and compassion and understanding. And we give thanks for those in hospitals, nursing homes and people at home who care for the sick. Strengthen them, give them the courage to face their ordeal. It is your will, restore them to full health and strength. But whatever happens, we pray that you would encircle them in your ever-loving arms so they know that they are loved and blessed. And our prayers for other people. We ask your prayers for all who face conflict, for those for whom life is an endless struggle, for those who are uncertain where their next meal will come from or if it will come at all, for those for whom life seems dark and empty, and for those who are hungry in our greedy world. For those sent away from the rich nation's table empty-handed, although there is enough and for all. And we think of people in our own land who are facing increased bills for food and heat and rent and increased taxes, who may well be wondering how they're going to cope. We know there are no easy solutions, but we do know that society society could be organised in a way which takes more care of those people in the greatest need. We ask your prayers for all who face conflict, and we think especially of the people of Ukraine who are suffering terribly at this time, and who've pushed onto the back pages people in Syria, Yemen and Afghanistan, people who all over the world are facing conflict, civil war, brutality. We know that this is not your will for mankind, that your will is that we live in peace, peace with you, peace with ourselves, and above all, peace with one another. And so we pray for peace. And we pray that it will come quickly. And we pray for those who are persecuted, all who are tortured and imprisoned for their faith in Christ. For all who are neglected, ignored, made to feel as if they don't count. For those who, for the sake of others, stand against injustice, corruption, and evil, and do so at great cost to themselves. And we ask your prayers for all who face conflict, for those whose sickness has broken their spirit, for those whose ill health has worn them down, for those whose illness has restricted the lives of their families, and for those who have lost their freedom as they are more concerned for the old and the infirm. For all who take up the battle to bring wholeness, healing, renewal and hope. And for all who are committed to prayer and to love. Lord, hear our prayers, for we bring them in the name of Christ, who shares all our conflicts. Amen. Amen. And now we're going to sing hymn number 223. When I find it. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. 223.
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ.
steps and obey his commands, and in the power of the Holy Spirit to guide us and bless us. Amen.
Amen.
You were paying more attention to what was going on there today than most of the congregation.